We are going to discuss a new topic on drug proving. Drug proving is a very important topic for a proper understanding of homeopathy and its principle. And it is equally important for your exams. The homeopathic drug proving. So what is a drug proving? The definition says it is a process of acquiring a knowledge of instruments intended for the cure of natural diseases. And it is given in aphorism 105. And all of you know that drug proving is one of the seven doctrine in homeopathy. Dr. Hahnemann, he developed the concept of drug proving along with the concept of similarity. But it is not Dr. Hahnemann who discovered drug proving. It was done by a well-known physician and botanist of 17th century, Albert von Haller. He was the first person besides Hahnemann who felt the need of testing medicine for their pure and peculiar effect in deranging the health of the man. In order to learn what morbid state each medicine is capable of curing, Dr. Hahnemann accidentally struck with the idea of taking mother tincture of cinchona, followed by the development of the symptom of malaria. Hahnemann deducted the concept of drug proving, and he got the concept of drug proving together with the concept of similarity. It was not a later idea of Hahnemann. From this accidental proving, he deducted the whole concept of drug proving. When he took cinchona mother tincture, knowingly or unknowingly, he found that it could produce symptoms. And that was the basis of drug proving. So we can conclude that it is a systematic and orderly way of investigating the pathogenetic power of medicine. Let us examine the three principles together, which are the cornerstones of homeopathy. Similibus similibus curandum, drug proving, and the doctrine of single remedy. Among this, the central position should be given to drug proving. From the accidental proving, he got the idea of similibus similibus curandum, and he confirmed that the idea was further proceed to drug proving. Naturally, the concept of single remedy came up. So these three principles have evolved together. That is why I told you similima similibus is a deductive reasoning of Hahnemann, whereas drug proving is a material reality of unexpected finding of Hannah. From this unexpected finding, he made a deduction that is similia similibus curandum. So similia similibus curandum is secondary to drug proving. That is the unexpected finding of Hahnemann after taking Singona bond. So this is the background of drug proving, which was discovered by Dr. Hahnemann. And we are going to discuss about the process of drug proving as done by Hahnemann, as well as the modification made by Central Council of Research in Homeopathy for investigating the pathogenetic power of drug, which they called as HPT, that is homeopathic pathogenetic trial. So we discuss the topic on drug proving by combining the concept of Hahnemann as well as the protocol of CCRH. Now coming to the objective of drug proving, the first objective is to know the pathogenetic effect of drug, that is the disease producing effect of drug upon healthy human being. The next objective is to observe and note the alternation of normal sensation by the production of subjective symptoms. You all know what is a subjective symptom. A subjective symptom is a symptom which can be experienced by an individual alone. So a third person, the other person, cannot perceive the symptom. Only the subject can perceive the symptom. So such symptoms having a very high value in homeopathic prescriptions. Now the next objective is to observe and note the derivations in the appearance on the surface, changes in the tissue, organs, changes in the physiological functions, etc. So these are in general called objective symptoms. So these symptoms can be seen by or perceived by other person or a third person. So such symptoms in general are called objective symptoms. So that is also one of the objective of drug proving. Now the next objective is to bring out the characteristic of the drug as they manifest in diseased state. So each drug should have a characteristic symptoms. To elicit the characteristic symptoms of the drug is one of the objective of drug proving. And you all know characteristic symptoms are the keynote symptoms to identify a drug, and it carries the highest value in homeopathic symptomatology. General scheme of testing the drug. So it involves three basic components of drug proving. So what are the three basic components in drug proving? They are the test drug, that is an essential component, the proving team, and the procedure. So now we'll discuss about the test drug. So according to Hahnemann, what are the qualities to be possessed by a substance to be nominated as a test drug? So number one is it should be pure. That means it should be free from mixtures and other drugs, and it possesses all its active properties. So that is the first quality of a test drug. Now the second quality is to administer indigenous plants in the form of freshly expressed juice mixed with little alcohol. So in Hahnemann time, most of the drug he proved are European plants, that is indigenous to Hahnemann. So he advocate to administer these plants in the form of fresh juice, slightly mixed with alcohol. Suppose the plants are not available locally, some of the drug substances should be imported from other countries. So these drug substances are called exotic drug substance. So it should be administered in the form of powder or in mother tincture with alcohol when in fresh state, and later it can be mixed with a little part of water. So that is how an exotic vegetable substance to be taken for the purpose of proving the drug. Now suppose if you're taking the salts or gums, it should be dissolved in water just before taking it for the purpose of the proving. Suppose if you are taking a dry or weak medicinal substance, you should make the infusion of that and swallow while in warm state. Suppose if you are taking a strong and heroic drug substance, like addiction forming drug, suppose if it is a poisonous drug, it should be taken in the form of small doses. If you are taking a mild medicines, it should be taken in a large quantity, considerable quantity. To prove very weakest medicine on a delicate, irritable and sensitive person. So a very weakest medicine, if the medicine does not have a very strong action, it can be proved in a delicate and irritable or a sensitive person. And these substances should be proved in a very high dilutions, high potencies. Suppose if you want to prove a poison or a venom or heavy metals, it should be only proved in a potentized form, not in a crude form. Dosage, what are the dosages he recommend? To give a medicine to an experimenter on an empty stomach daily, 4 to 6 very small globules of 30th potency. And this method of dosage is a recommendation of CCRH in homeopathic pathogenetic trial. Hahnemann advocate, initially he advocate to take in massive doses, large doses in the form of mother tinctures, and later he reduced the dosage, the quantity of medicines. And Hahnemann's last advice was to give the medicine in 30th potency. If the effects are slight, a few more globules may be taken daily until the symptoms appears. To carry out the proving on a drug with a different range of potencies. So a drug should be taken in various potencies for an exhaustive proving of that particular drug. To administer placebo on the same color and texture in the same way in an experimental group. So this is a new concept in homeopathic pathogenetic trial, not in Hahnemannian proving, that an experimental group and a placebo group. So two groups should be there to understand if there any placebo effect is there. So what is a placebo? A placebo is a non-medicated substance. It does not contain any medication. Next component is a proving team. The proving team consists of the project director or a master prover, the advisor or an expert, the proving supervisor or a panel of investigators, the provers. So first we'll discuss about a project director. So who can be a project director and what are his responsibilities? So a well-experienced homeopathic physician, well-versed with the methodology of proving, can be a project director. He makes plans for the entire proving, determines the quality of the test substance, its dose, selection of provers, and involvement of other team members. He works in recording and analysis of proving data, ensures highest standards of proving, coordinate with the people involved in proving, ensures the safety of provers, and takes overall view of the project. So one can consider the project director or master prover is the sole authority of the entire proving procedure. Next person is an advisor or an expert. Advisor or expert is not directly involved in a drug proving process. So he only assists the project director or master prover. So who can be an advisor or an expert? A qualified botanist, a zoologist, or a chemist, microbiologist, or a physician can be an advisor. He provides the characteristic details of the test substance, assists the project director, and provides the information about the pharmacological action of the test substance and its biological study on lab animals. He certified the health of the prover and conduct necessary examination and investigation before, during, and after proving. Next member of team is proving supervisors or panel of investigators. So qualified and experienced homeopath can be the provers, proving supervisors or panel of investigators. He is preferred to have an experience in previous provings. He should be unprejudiced, having a sound sensor, and a keen observer. And remember, the proving supervisor or panel of investigators are in direct contact with the provers. They are the people who interrogate with provers about the symptoms they experienced. He establishes a communication between a prover and the project director. He ensures that the symptoms of proving are recorded properly in the prover's day book. Now the last and very important a member of team, that is a prover. So what are the qualities to become a prover? The first and foremost quality is he should be apparently healthy human being. So I called them apparently healthy because no one is perfectly healthy. So a prover should be almost healthy. He should be intelligent enough to elicit the symptoms he produced. He should be sensitive enough to prove a drug. He should be delicate, irritable, and trustworthy. So here the words delicate and irritable simply means that they are so sensitive to prove a mild medicine also. So if these qualities are present, then we call the prover as ideal prover. The provers can be from both sexes, from all age groups and various constitutions, whether obese, bulky, or a lean, doesn't matter. So it should be proved in all the constitutions and different localities. The prover can be from a mountain area, a hilly area, can be from a seaside. It can be from a very temperate climate, from a cold climate, etc. So from different weather conditions. Proving should not be done on a sick person because of the following reasons. The first thing is the symptoms of natural disease. A sick person may be affected with the natural disease. And when you prove a drug, then artificial disease, a medicinal disease may be evolved, so it can be mixed up. So that is why we should not prove on sick person. Sometimes sick person may be hyper or hypersensitive. So the intensity of the symptoms may vary. Suppose sometimes the intensity of symptoms may be more if the sick persons are hypersensitive. If they are hypersensitive, the intensity of the symptom may be less. There is a chance of cure or palliation is possible. Sometimes if the medicinal symptoms and the natural symptoms are similar, then there is a chance of cure may be possible. If the drug is dissimilar to the disease, it may have no effect or may form a complex disease. So that also may be possible. So because of these reasons, the drug should not be proved in a sick person. And I told you, a homeopathic drug proving should be done in a healthy human being. It should not be done in a lower animal. Because of these reasons, subjective and mental symptoms are not available in animal proving. So I told you about the importance of subjective and mental symptoms. It can be perceived only by an intelligent human being. Cannot be done by a lower animal. And these symptoms, subjective and mental symptoms, are having a very high value in a homeopathic prescription. So we need to elicit the subjective and mental symptoms in drug proving, and it is one of the objective of drug proving. Modalities and finer sensation are lacking in lower animals. To perceive the characteristic symptoms of a drug, we need modalities and the sensations. So that is lacking in animal proving. Effect of drugs on animal and human being is not identical. Substance subjected to complete study of animal found to be toxic to humans. Sometimes a substance which are not toxic to animals may found toxic to humans. Lab animals do not react in same way to the action of drug as humans. So these are the things which made a proving unable in a lower animal. Then who can be a best prover? A healthy, unprejudiced, sensitive physician who can understand the changes in the body and mind during drug proving distinctly and express that in a proper words. Why a physician is a best prover? Because he knows the principles of homeopathy. He knows how to perceive the symptoms due to the pathogenic power of drug, and mostly they are unprejudiced. Another word is idiosyncratic prover. Who is an idiosyncratic prover? A person is the best possible prover of a substance to which he is or she is idiosyncratic. Idiosyncrasy means it is a state of hypersensitiveness to a particular substance. So idiosyncratic prover is a best prover for that particular substance. Now the procedure of drug proving. So regarding the drug, must be well known, pure, genuine and thoroughly assured. We already discussed that. Must be taken in a simple, unadulterated form. So the drug should be proved singly. Must not given for several successive days in ever increasing doses. So once the prover starts the symptoms, then the drug should be stopped. Avoid administration of large doses, which brings out secondary reaction. But hurried appearance of primary symptoms is unsuitable for the study. Usually, we expect the primary symptoms to be noted. Regarding the prover, should not take any other medicine on the same day or during the proving. Take only simple and nutritious diet. This is Hahnemannian guidelines. Young green peas, green French beans, carrots are allowed. Green vegetables, roots, salads, herb soups, and spices should be avoided. This is only the guidelines of Hahnemann. Avoid beverages. Avoid all dissipation and disturbing patients. No urgent business to distract attention. Always stay in a calm. Devote to careful self-observation. That is very, very essential. Then only we will come to know that what changes are taking place within us. Stick to normal habits and routine. You need not change your normal habits and routine. Avoid any extraneous influences. A long traveling, sleepless night. So these can be avoided. Avoid strenuous activity or games. So excessive activities. Any physical work can be avoided. Now, how to record the symptoms? I told you, the provers are recording the symptom, noting the symptoms in a specialized book called as day book, where they record the symptoms on daily basis with time of onset, a sensation, discomfort, temperature, pain, alternation in health activity, etc. So whatever the alternation you observe from the normal life can be noted in a day book. A record of occurrence of symptoms. So here the symptoms should be recorded in the following manner. The time of onset, location, any extension or shifting, sensation, what is the sensation felt by the prover, modality, what are the circumstances which modify the symptoms, any concomitants, any other symptoms comes along with the main symptoms. So these are the pattern of noting the symptoms. And also from the report from the friends and relatives, any objective symptoms can be perceived from friends and relatives. Dreams, delusions, fears, fantasies, emotions, thoughts, impulses, and other mental symptoms which a prover can himself can narrate it could be taken. Exact time of onset of symptoms, their chronological sequence. What is a chronological sequence? Which symptoms appears first, which one is second? So that is a chronological order. The manner of occurrences, how it occurs, whether it occurs in a drastically rapid or a slow onset, duration, how long the symptoms was there, nature of symptoms, whether it is a mild or a moderate or a severe symptom, whether it is a continuous or intermittent symptom, whether the onset is slow or rapid, the exact site of appearance of symptoms, that is a primary location, if it is radiated to any site or any shifting of symptoms, modalities with factors of aggravation and amelioration. Aggravation means the circumstance which increase the symptoms. Amelioration means the circumstance which decrease the symptoms, as change of posture, rest, movement, pressure, thermal, or any food or drink, and its relationship to the normal physiological functions. Any cravings and aversions with respect to the food or climate or position or whatever it may be. Any change in the normal physiological function such as taste, touch, appetite, thirst, sleep, vision, hearing, perspiration, discharges, digestion, sexuality, etc. Any possibility of external causative factors other than the test track that could produce the symptoms. That means, suppose raining, or a cold climate, or draft of cold wind, exposure to sunlight. So these are the external causative factors which can be modify the existing symptoms. So that can be noted. Any new symptoms appeared during the drug proving. Any current symptoms intensified during proving. Any current symptom modified or altered with description. For a narcotic substances, addiction forming drug substance, only secondary symptoms are noted. Please remember, only secondary symptoms are noted, or symptoms of secondary actions are noted in narcotic substances. Substance other than narcotics, except narcotics, symptoms of primary symptoms, that is symptoms of primary action, is noted. That is very, very important. Alternating action can be produced by some drugs. So if alternating action is produced by some drugs, that should be noted. For example, what is alternative action? Diarrhea and constipation produced by opium or Naxomica. So these two vivid actions, it is opposite action, constipation and diarrhea. So these are not primary action, secondary action. It is these two symptoms are belongs to primary symptom, but it is opposite to each other, and such type of symptoms are called as alternating symptoms or alternating actions. Modalities in relation to time, position, weather, etc. Any alternation from the normal health. Very old symptoms or new symptoms. Very old. Suppose during drug proving, there may be some appearance of symptoms which had appeared in your early childhood. So that is a reappearing of the old symptoms. So if that is present, it should be noted. So if the medicine is given in a moderate doses, the primary action or primary effect observed distinctly. So the first, the primary symptoms will be appear. If you give the large doses of medicine, symptoms not elicited distinctly, because the primary symptoms cannot be obtained, because the primary effect appear in hurry or nothing distinct. We cannot separate the primary and secondary action of the drug. Secondary effect mixed up with the primary effects. Sometimes the toxic effect may be developed. Suppose the drug substance, when you, if you are using is a toxic substance, the toxic effect may develop. So this is about the procedure of drug proving. So here I am combining both some aspects of homeopathic pathogenetic trial, as well as the Hahnemannian method of drug proving.